As you know, one third of humanity is infected with tubercle bacillus. They may show overt infection or they may show subclinical infection. So, genitourinary tuberculosis is always secondary post primary tuberculosis. Primary focus can be in the list, which is lungs, intestines, skin, and tonsil. So in cases of GU cox, primary focus will be very difficult to locate. Other sources can be through it can also be through sexually transmitted, like infected vaginal secretions, infected semen, oral sex, and intravesical BCG can also lead to tuberculosis, genitourinary tuberculosis. So about mycobacteria, as you all know very well, acid fast and alcohol fast, because of mycolic acid and cell wall integrity. They are aerobic, non-motile, non-capsulated, non-spore-bearing bacteria. Zeal-Wilson stains, you all very know well. The only issue with tuberculosis bacteria was it grows very slowly in culture. It may take 6 to 8 weeks. So the culture reports used to take a lot of time. So now new diagnostic methods and tests have been come, which makes the diagnosis of mycobacterial tuberculosis faster, so that the treatment can be started in adequate time, which is very essential, especially in GU tuberculosis, to save the renal unit. Mycobacteria has also tendency to lie dormant, and you all know Robert Koch discovered the bacteria in 1882. That's why it is also known as Koch's disease. Etymology: they are slender rods that sometimes shows branching filament forms resembling fungal mycelium, hence the name fungus like bacteria. They do not stain readily, but once stained they resist decolorization with dilute mineral acid, hence they are acid fast. They resist decolorization and they are gram positive. So tuberculosis in humans can be caused by Mycobacterium tuberculosis or Mycobacterium buis. Then others are Mycobacterium smegmaticus and atypical mycobacteria. Cultivation in solid medium, Loeffler's serum slope, Dorset egg, and Ornstein Jensen medium, as we all know, and liquid media are Dubose medium. So how they grow? Mycobacterium tuberculosis will be dry, raised, irregular, and tenacious colonies, while bovis will be moist, flat, smooth, and friable colonies. These are very important thing you should know. Pathogenesis: microfocus in parenchyma. Once they form a microfocus in parenchyma, they will start shedding into the urine and there will be bacilluria. So urine will show acid fast AFB, acid fast bacteria, or tubercular bacteria. If they form multiple foci, they can develop miliary tuberculosis. They can lead to extensive inflammation, caseous kidney, putty kidney, and pseudocalculi, calcification, dense multiple calcification. These inflammatory tubercles can coalesce, they may form and rupture into an abscess, and which can spread outside kidney, perinephric spread. The renal pyramid can get ulcerated and destructed, which will form a cavernoma. In PUJ, pelvic uterine junction, they can cause narrowing stricture, which will lead to hydronephrosis, pyonephrosis. Vesicoureteric junction also can lead to hydronephrosis, hydroureteronephrosis, pyoureteronephrosis, and vesicoureteric reflux. They can infect bacteria and can lead to severe dense inflammation, cystitis, and ultimately will lead to thimble bladder. Very small, 50 ml capacity bladder, thimble bladder. So what is thimble? Thimble is like small cap worn by tailors to protect their thumbs from needle injury. That's why it is called thimble bladder. So the capacity will be as small as that. So it can be less than 50 ml bladder capacity. Then urethral involvement per se is very rare, maybe because of the transit time of bacteria in urethra. So in urethra, generally urine will not be stored or static, it will flow out. So the transit time is faster, that's why the urethra involvement is rare. So genitourinary cocks, renal renal and genital infection without bladder involvement, with bladder involvement. Infected urine can go into prostatic ducts, ejaculatory ducts, and then it can involve epididymis, seminal vesicles. Epididymis can also get infected through bloodborne arrival of bacteria and lead to severe epididymitis, and it can be a primary genital infection also. The incidence is mostly in 20 to 40 years of age. Male female preponderance is 2:1. The patient who are HIV or retroviral positive disease with very low immunity, they have a higher incidence of getting genitourinary tuberculosis or any form of tuberculosis, as you all know. 20% is extra pulmonary tuberculosis is renal or GU tuberculosis, and it's very uncommon in children. So what are the classical symptoms? We all know evening rise of temperature. So you can remember with F, that's why I have started everything with F. Fever in the evening, frequency of urine. Why there will be frequency? First, because of severe inflammation. Second, because of decreased bladder capacity, as I told, thimble bladder, decreased bladder capacity. So bladder capacity will be very small. So as soon as patient stores 30-50 ml urine, his bladder appears, he feels sensation of full bladder and he needs to pass urine. The intense frequency means patient might be passing urine every 5 to 10 minutes, hourly, half an hourly. They can pass 30 to 50 times a day, they have to go to urine. So there will be intense frequency. Then evening rise of temperature is other important feature. Then flank pain because of abscess, calcifications. Then urine will be maybe foul and turbid urine. Then features of stranguri. So patient stranguri, as we have discussed in the earlier classes, is painful infective maturation. Features of stranguri, and few will be having painless hematuria. Painless hematuria, 5% of cases may present with painless hematuria. Hello? Hello? अच्छा मैं तो बोलूँ ना नया मैं बोल देता हूँ ना क्योंकि ना इधर बाहर आया हुआ हूँ अब भी वहाँ से निकला हूँ तो ना तू वहाँ भी भेज दे मैं फोन करके बोल नाम क्या उनका मोहन सिंह रोड ना चल मैं फोन करके बोल देता हूँ देख लेंगे करके अभी कैसे हो ठीक है अच्छा ठीक है मैं बोल देता हूँ हाँ मैं सीधा ना इसी में शिफ्ट करा देता हूँ उनको भी हाँ मैं बोल देता हूँ बिल्कुल देखने के लिए ठीक है आपका हो गया ना तो अभी फिर से बोलना पड़ेगा क्या पुराना
नहीं
कंटिन्यू करेंगे ना ठीक सो आई थिंक आई वाज नॉट ऑडिबल सो बट यू हैव सीन द स्लाइड्स सो विल मूव फॉरवर्ड So there can also be a hemospermia. So blood in the sperm. So what are the signs? Palpable renal palpability. So kidney might be enlarged, calcification, perinephric inflammation, caseous necrosis. So there will be renal kidney may be palpable, large kidneys. Bruise can be heard, which is a sign of advanced destruction. Seminal vesicles may appear. In the DRE, digital rectal examination, craggy feeling of seminal vesicles, which are generally in rectal examination, until unless they are enlarged, you cannot feel seminal vesicles. Epididymis will be non-tender enlargement of epididymis. Generally, epididymitis of any other bacterial infection, epididymorchitis, there will be pronounced tenderness. But in tuberculosis, And tubercular enlargement epidemics, there will be non-tender enlargement. So this is very important thing to differentiate. Restricted mobility of testis, VAS, very specific in VAS, you can feel beaded VAS, irregular nodularity and beading of VAS. This is very typical of tuberculosis. Then you can also notice in advanced diseases, sinuses and ulcers over the back of scrotum, as you can see in the provided image, sinuses and ulcer in the back of scrotum. So what all investigations you ask? So apart from routine investigations, what we do for any patient, the most important specific investigations are erythrocyte sedimentation rate, which is a sign of chronic infection. It is not specific for tuberculosis. Sterile pyuria is one very important feature of tuberculosis. So in urine, routine microscopy examination will show plenty of pus cells, but in routine culture will be negative for routine organisms. Then you can obtain AFB culture, AFB smear and culture, both should be done. AFB smear, the most important thing when you are doing for GU cox. So the AFB in urine, whenever you ask, you have to tell first void, first sample of the morning. When patients get up, the first urine what he passes shall be and must be sent for AFB smear and culture, because overnight accumulation and shedding of bacteria will be accumulated, and that will be that will increase the yield of your smear and culture. So there is the most important thing, first void, and at least three samples should be taken. Even after that, the yield of AFB smear and culture is only 30% in patients of tuberculosis. So still, if AFB routine smear and culture is negative, still there are 60-70% chances of patient having renal tuberculosis. Then nowadays we routinely ask for PCR, DNA and RNA, RT-PCR. So TB gold is very important test, TB gold, RT-PCR and CBNAT. These are the most important thing which we gives diagnosis earlier. And also CBNAT, in CBNAT is nucleic acid amplification test, PCR. CBNAT will also provide you resistance of anti-tubercular drug, especially rifampicin. And if you have any demonstrable lesion, you can take a biopsy and send it for AFB. Then tuberculin test is not that diagnostic, or it doesn't have much of a negative or positive predictive value in the current scenario, because most of Indian subpopulation will may be having subclinical tubercular infection. So the tuberculin test might be falsely positive. And also always screen patient for retroviral disease, always. So apart from blood investigations, now the second most armamentarium is ultrasonography, which may show PCS dilatation, irregular dilatation of pelvic calyceal system. Then DAISY sign. DAISY sign is dilated calyces without a pelvis. Pelvis may not be seen because pelvis may have become contracted, small, short, rigid, contracted pelvis, but the calyces will be dilated because of the infundibulum stenosis. So this is called a DAISY sign. And you can observe perinephric collections, calcifications, multiple cavities, size may be enlarged. And in the ultrasound, especially in transrectal ultrasound, you can see any seminal vesicular pathology. The second most important investigations is urogram. It can be done either intravenous urogram, IU or IVP, or CT urogram, or contrast tomographic, computerized tomographic urography. So in IVU, as you can see in the this film, there are multiple calcifications. Here you can see the most important thing is infundibular stenosis, which is pathognomonic of cox. So you can see here infundibulum is very narrow. Here you can see infundibulum is not seen because it is so narrow. So infundibular stenosis and is very pathognomonic. And apart from that, the cupping of calluses, you can see the calluses have become blunt and rounded here. So generally calluses will be cupped. So this cupping is lost. So this is very pathognomonic of tuberculosis. Then thimble bladder, as you can see, very small capacity thimble bladder, very small capacity. You can see vesicoureteric reflux. You can see vesicoureteric reflux of the urine into the ureter and pelvic alveolar system. So you can see this is the bladder Foley's bulb, Foley catheter bulb, and you can see how much is the bladder capacity. So Foley bulb is hardly you can inflate 20-30 ml, and this bladder doesn't look like more than 50 ml capacity. So thimble bladder. Then cystoscopy when indicated, it can be normal in a patient of tuberculosis. The ureteric efflux can be absent, or it can be frequent, or it can be cloudy, or it can be bloody. It can be anything. Then the most important sign is pallor around ureteric orifice. Pallor around ureteric orifice is very important sign. Then pouting of ureteric orifices. You can see observed tubercles in the bladder. You can see ulcerations in the bladder. And the one of the important features of tuberculosis is golf holing of the ureteric orifices. Ureteric orifice may be golf hole shaped. These are the very important signs. And then you can observe, as soon as you enter into the bladder through cystoscope, you can observe profuse bleeding, which is one of the signs of tuberculosis, and very small capacity thimble bladder. Retrograde pyelogram. As you can see, we have injected dye from the ureteric orifice into the ureter, and you can see there is a long segment stricture in the ureter. See, this is a normal ureter, and this is completely stricture segment, and then again normal ureter, then again there is narrowing, and then again, so multiple long strictures of the ureter is the one of the signs of tuberculosis. CT scan is another armamentarium. As you can see, this bladder is completely gone because of tuberculosis. Here also there is a cyst and perinephric collection. So apart from these described investigations, MRI, NGO or radionuclide studies, they don't provide any further investigation information. So they are not used routinely in the diagnosis of tuberculosis. So most important is your blood investigations, urine investigations, chest x-ray, ultrasound, CT or conventional IVU. So what about treatment? Treatment consists of four parts. One is anti-cox therapy or anti-tubercular therapy. Your second aim is to protect the renal unit and preserve the function, whatever remaining function the renal unit has. You have to protect it and preserve the function. If required, you have to reconstruct, like ureteric stricture, you have to reconstruct. Bladder, small bladder, you have to reconstruct. And the fourth is ablate, so remove the system. When they are non-reconstructable, so you have to remove that system to remove the focus of infection to protect the contralateral unit, renal unit. So the last option is to ablate the unit. So AKT, as you all know, first line is isoniazid, rifampicin, rifabutine, pyrazinamide, ethambutol and rifapentine, which is not used. So basically five drugs. Second line, streptomycin, capreomycin, kanamycin, amikacin, cycloserine, ethionamide, quinolones, PAS, amikacin and kanamycin. These all you would have read very well. So 40% resistance to at least one of the drug is observed in the TU cox. So within host there can be four subpopulations of cox bacteria. They either may be rapidly multiplying, slow growers, intermittent growers or dormant. So rapidly multiplying, the drugs which work well is isoniazid, rifampicin and streptomycin. Slow growers, pyrazinamide. Intermittent growers, rifampicin. For dormant form, there are no drugs. So you have to prevent this dormant form by increasing the immunity and giving adequate number and time of drug. So there are two phases of treatment: initiative, intensive phase to kill bacilli rapidly, and second is continuation phase to destroy any persisting bacteria which will reduce the relapse. 6 to 9 month regime is recommended. DOTS is directly observed treatment short course, that you have read well. So types of infection: it can be drug sensitive infection, it can be a multi-drug resistant tuberculosis. So categories you know well, we'll skip it. So these are categories you know well. So what regime you give: smear positive, isoniazid 600 mg, rifampicin 450. These are roughly doses. These are basically should be calculated according to the body weight. So 5 to 10 mg per kg of isoniazid, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, ethambutol thrice weekly for 2 months, followed by continuation phase of isoniazid and rifampicin thrice weekly for 4 months. Multidrug resistant tuberculosis is defined as resistance to isoniazid and rifampicin with or without resistance to other agent. So MDR is defined as resistance to isoniazid and rifampicin with or without resistance to other agents. So for treatment of MDR is 18 to 24 months. So always encourage patient who are on AKT to take drug adequately and timely for prescribed duration. If they skip doses or if they default in the treatment, they will end up in MDR, which is very difficult to treat. And you have to use a second line drug, out of which at least 3 should be unused drug and 1 should be injectable. That's why intermittent treatment should not be used. So in MDR, it's better to do hospital based treatment or domiciliary directly observed treatment. So one most important point in GeoCox is role of double J stenting. So as soon as there is a confirmed diagnosis of tuberculosis, there are no fixed guidelines, but we prefer to indwell a stent, deploy a DJ stent, because over a period of time, when with drug start with initiation of AKT, there will be healing with fibrosis which will lead to ureteric stricture. So prior stenting is required. So this is the most important thing. And the second use of stenting is when there are already narrowing and stricture in the ureter, you can attempt passing a stent so that further reconstruction can be delayed till the at least first 2 months of intensive phase is over. Second is reconstruction. So any reconstruction means ureteric stricture, you have to excise the stricture part and do end-to-end anastomosis if it is feasible. If it is not feasible, then you have to do ileal replacement of the ureter. Ileal replacement of the ureter. And for small capacity bladder, you have to augment the capacity of bladder, which is called as augmentation cystoplasty. So one few things: never do transureteroureterostomy in patient with renal TB. So don't join one ureter to other ureter in case of tuberculosis, because you can damage the other ureter also by introducing the bacteria. Then the as we discussed about Bowari flap, bladder flap can be raised in few cases to fill the gap of deficient ureter, but in tuberculosis there is not enough bladder, so it cannot be done. So this is the picture of ileal ureter. Here you can see we have placed ileum, you can see, and we have joined to anastomosis to upper ureter, and down we have anastomosis to bladder. So this is the ileal ureter replacement. One thing very important which should be checked is any stigmata of tuberculosis in the bowel, especially ileocecal area, which is prone for GI tuberculosis. So you should be very careful and cautious while using these segments. The last resort when nothing else works is ablation. Ablation means removal of the unit, nephrouretrectomy to be done. So to protect the other better contralateral kidney. So what is the important thing? While on treatment, monitor renal functions, urea and creatinine, weekly and bi-weekly imaging to see the response or deterioration, timely DJ stenting if required, If stenting is not possible, you have to put a percutaneous nephrostomy to drain the kidney. And in epididymis, if it is not responding, you may have to do epididymectomy. So there is a very famous term for Cox's kidney, autonephrectomy, which is a nature's ineffective effort to contain infection. So you can see in autonephrectomy, you calcification in the area of kidney, IVU, that kidney will not be visualized, and no efflux will be there on cystoscopy, that unit is non-functioning. So autonephrectomy means it is non-functioning, non-visualized kidney, which is a form of calcified tombstone. So to remove it or leave it, it is a debatable issue, and there are no fixed consensus on this. So do read about this GU tuberculosis, go through it again. I have discussed this very fast, so that later once you read, then we can rediscuss as these things, this corona things get. So we can have face to face conversation on this, and we can clear each other's doubt on that.